Welcome back to The Breakfast on Plus TV Africa. We're now getting straight into our first topical discussion, and it's about the Occupy Lekki toll gate. You know, this event was on Saturday, February 13th, 2021, and there's been a lot of controversy regarding Saturday. Would the protest hold or not? You know, we saw that the Lagos State government had deployed, you know, heavily armed policemen to the Lekki toll gate. You know, they had, you know, kept watch, they had kept a vigil there, you know, from Friday, you know, trying to make sure that nobody came out to protest the reopening of the, you know, Lekki toll gate or its repossession by the Lekki concession company. And the events of Saturday wasn't, you know, quite pleasant, as we saw lots of people who got arrested. You know, we saw a few people who were stripped, you know, bitten, according to eyewitness account of one of the celebrities who was there, you know, Debo, also known as MC Macaroni. We've now invited here, you know, two guests to discuss this with us: Liborous, Oshoma, legal practitioner, as well as Nejeeb Bello, a socio-political analyst. Good morning, Nejeeb Bello. Thanks for joining us.
Good morning. Thank you for having me.
And thanks again, Mr. Liborous, Oshoma, for being here.
A pleasure.
All right, let's begin with Mr. Nejeeb Bello. We discussed this issue the other time. We talked about how, you know, it seemed like the protest was brewing. You know, people had come out to say that Saturday, February 13th, they were going to come out and protest. And we spoke about how the government needed to speak up, the panel needed to maybe retract. And eventually, what happened on Saturday happened. How did you feel about it, seeing the turnout of the police and how protesters and passers-by were both treated?
Of course, it was saddening to see even the level of preparation that the police made towards this protest. We saw all sorts of armed men, fully kitted. These are the kind of men you don't see chasing Boko Haram. These are the kind of men you don't see chasing bandits. But they came prepared to cart away, to arrest and torture peaceful protesters. It was, I did feel that it was the wrong move from the government. This is not how to handle such things. From the very get-go, the problem was with the panel declaring that LCC should take over that toll gate. And we saw the role LCC played in the whole saga. It's quite sad, though, and to see that the company, the LCC company, along with the security agents, along with the Lagos government, and even to an extent the panel, they are all on one side in this issue.
All right. I'm going to go to Liborous Oshoma. I was there for a few minutes on Saturday, and a lot of what I saw at the time that I was there was police simply picking up people. Some of them were passers-by, some of them, you know, actually came to protest, and everyone was just immediately grabbed and thrown into the police vehicle. So I want your quick response to that. Was the Nigerian police at that time simply there to ensure that the peace of Lagos was not disrupted and the toll gate was protected at all cost? Or did they have genuine reasons to ensure that, you know, the protest didn't happen?
It wasn't about peace of Lagos. We should get that straight. There is no... Ever since I've been, you know, young student and active in protest, there has never been any protest in Nigeria where you don't have police presence first. But it keep getting worse yearly. With successive government, it keep getting worse. Even under the military, you know, you remember the anti-SAP riot and all of that. You know, you have police presence, you have army presence. In some cases, you know, depending on the government, they will tell the police to just, initially was you need permits to protest. Even Alhaji Lai Mohammed alluded to it with these NSAS protests. Yes, you have a right to do it, but you should do it, you know, with the parameters of permits. And the court had consistently ruled that you do not need anybody's consent to peacefully assembly and protest. And Section 22 even guarantees that the press can hold government accountable to you. So if the people are not, you know, empowered to hold government accountable, then, you know, who would hold the government accountable? So, and that's why I see and I feel that, yes, you can have police, but ensure that there's no breakdown of law and order. But the situation where the police would come and then arrested discriminately. It is not even, it was not just in Lekki toll gate. In Lagos on Saturday, as far as Bagada, Ikeja, the areas where you have playgrounds, where people usually go to play football on Saturdays, the police in Lagos, they condoled off all of those places and refused even people from coming out to exercise or play football. In Bagada playground, they went there, the DPO in Ifako went there and condoled off the area and said, you know, the area commander said they should not allow anybody to gather. You know, and so I now ask myself, if you are that scared of peaceful protest, and yet you accommodate bandits, you look the other way when killer headsmen ravage community, you are very comfortable with kidnapping, you do not, you know, prepare like this to attack these ills in the society, which message are you passing to the people? That it is better for you to go and be a bandit, to be a kidnapper, to be violent, than to be a peaceful protester. That's the message. And then, I don't take people like Loretta Onoche seriously. These are people who do not engage their brain before they open their mouth. And why the police commissioner is promising that they are setting up a panel to investigate the activities of the police on that day, you have somebody in Abuja commending the same police. The police have admitted, the police commissioner in Lagos had admitted that definitely their men, some of their men were alleged to have, you know, violated the rules of operation. And yet you have somebody in Abuja, you know, commending them. And you, what do you take somebody like that for? You, the obvious thing is that she didn't engage her brain before opening her mouth. She just wants to dance to the gallery. I expect her to respond to issues like this when it comes to Boko Haram, when it comes to killer headsmen, and when it comes to kidnapping, raping, and then, you know.
Let me bring in Nejeeb Bello for his thoughts on this one. Loretta Onoche, the aide to the president on social media, said, you know, she applauds the Nigerian police, gives kudos to them, you know, for the professional manner in which they conducted themselves at the Lekki toll gate yesterday, but we saw people, and we saw videos of people saying they were beaten, they were harassed, they were stripped. So what do you think about that and the contrary information we're getting from that day?
Okay, aside from you mentioning it and Mr. Liborous mentioning it, I do not listen to that lady, Mrs. Onoche. I don't listen to her anymore. In fact, the things she says are very outrageous. But that's that aside. We know that someone like Debo Adedayo, that's Mr. Macaroni, we saw him, the police themselves. It wasn't a stranger that made that video. It wasn't a protester that made the video. The police themselves made videos. In fact, these people implicated themselves in such ways that there's no way anybody can defend them. They stripped these people of their clothes, stacked them up in vehicles, like overcrowded places. They were sweating, there was nowhere. Some of them were sitting on each other's bodies, and they made videos where they were condemning them, where they were running them down, so abusing them. So there is nobody that will come and defend such a thing. You know, we saw the LCC people who are supposed to be a neutral party in this thing, like, oh, We are trying to take possession of our toll gate. So instead of them standing by and watching things happen, they actually went out to also help in detaining these people, throwing them into vehicles. You know, all sorts of things happened that Saturday that I wondered whether anybody thought things through before taking action on this. Even the police commissioner, Mr. Akim Odumosu, what did he tell his men before sending them there? He couldn't tell us that he didn't know his men were going to the Lekki toll gate. Was he not able to instruct them and say, okay, when you go there, this is how to act. These are the things to do. These are the things not to do. For him to act surprised at the way his men treated the protesters, that means either his men do not obey him, or he did not give them instructions, or he's actually in support of what they did. And it's only now, maybe some phone calls from different places have come through, and he's only now trying to act like, oh, there's some level. You can see LCC putting people into Black Maria, pushing the vehicles. They were aiding, they virtually carried out arrests, and we're going to see what law gives them the right to carry out arrests, to detain citizens, to harass them, you know? So everything that happened on that Saturday at the toll gate, from the law enforcement angle of things, it was very terribly wrong. And like Liborous said earlier, and I said this before in our previous interview, that with every protest that happens, the way the government and the security, look at that, the way the government and the security agents treat the citizens get worse. Instead of them reforming themselves and saying, okay, how can we treat these issues better? They come out with a more, it's like they've inflamed themselves, and they've gotten a lot of fire from their last actions, and they do even worse. Whoever he's saying, whoever the commissioner is saying they are going to punish, we've heard this several times before. If the previous ones who maltreated Nigerians, who beat up protesters and detained them wrongly, abused them, if they were dealt with the last time, then these new ones would not come out with such glee. Indeed. To harass citizens, to detain passersby.
Nejeeb Bello, let's try again. Okay.
Right.
First of all, you're seeing on your screen videos of several protesters and passersby being arrested. You can see people, you know, in Black Marias. Police have put them in there, and lots of people, basically, their rights been stripped, totally against the constitution, provisions of peaceful assembly and all of that. But really, I wanted to ask you, this question has been on the minds of many people. They say the way the police showed up at the Lekki toll gate on Saturday, I don't know if you've seen the police in such manner, the way they comported themselves, the way they gathered themselves. I don't know. Have you ever seen something like that in Lagos before? And the question many people have been asking is, we didn't even know, first of all, that, you know, we had as much police officers like this in Lagos, because we'd never seen them in this mass before. But the important thing is, where are these people when you need them the most? Where are these people when there are crimes? And lots of, you know, cartoons have been made about this. You know, somebody coming out to say, tell the police, you know, there are armed robbers at my house, and, you know, the police isn't doing anything. But there are peaceful protesters gathered out of my house, and there are people, you know, police rushing there. What are your thoughts on that?
To be honest, the way I saw the police assembled in at the Lekki toll gate, I really had not seen Nigeria police in that kind of formation before. The kind of gear they brought with them, I've faced the Nigerian police a couple of times over years. I've not seen them. Okay, I've seen the DSS come out like this, but the Nigeria police, regular Nigeria police, I've never seen them. And if this is how they go out against bandits, against terrorists, I am convinced that we would not have the kind of terrorism, banditry, and kidnapping that we are witnessing all over Nigeria. Now, let's come to Lagos specifically. Just last week, I think it was Friday, thugs and touts, so-called agberos and all of them, they were fighting, they were committing all sorts of violence in front of Camp Salem House at Obalende. This is like the police, a police headquarters in Lagos. And the police virtually did not come out. This happened for hours. The MURT and the RTN and all of them, they were fighting, they were throwing stones, they were carrying weapons, they were shooting in front of a police headquarters, and nothing happened. We didn't see the police come out. We did not see them do anything. We can't even see CCTVs, pictures of whoever was committing these crimes. We did not see them come out like this. And people are trying to peacefully protest. No weapons, no guns were shot. Out of all everybody they arrested, they didn't even see maybe a knife or a bottle or anything. And they came out and they packed this, but they had trucks. If this is how the police had been carrying out security responsibilities in Nigeria, in Lagos, all these years, Nigeria would not have any form of security challenges in the scale that we have today. So it's really a pity that this is how we dedicate our resources We deal with the peaceful ruthlessly, and we embrace and pardon the terrorists, the criminals, the kidnappers.
All right, let's go back to Liborous Oshoma. The videos that you can see there, not you know, in any way exciting. It looks really terrible. And it seems like the Nigerian police on that particular day were overly excited, you know, to serve and to ensure that they carry out.
But
I want you to speak about the legal, you know, aspects of all of this. What the police might, you know, be holding on to as their defense.
Nothing.
As the reasons why they carried out these actions. The protesters that I heard were charged with breaking COVID-19 guidelines.
Yeah.
Where all of these things, you know.
Look at even the police. Yes. Were they not breaking COVID-19 guidelines also? Did you see how many of them were not wearing face masks? You know, so let's, you see, when you're, like the local adage that says, when your father sends you to steal, you break the door. And so what you see playing out here is that, the police that are acting with such impunity were actually sent by somebody, you know, in authority. You know, go crush them. We don't want to see this in Lagos. We don't want all of this protest. But meanwhile, like Nejeeb has said, when the thugs that they use to rig election, to cause violence in the last protest, were wreaking havoc on, you know, on themselves and innocent properties and passers-by in Obalende, right before the former police headquarters, nothing happened. They didn't come out in this groove. And while all of this beating and harassment were happening, the governor's aide were posting picture of the governor buying roasted plantain by the roadside to show that the governor is humble. And you know, you begin to ask yourself, these people, is it that, you know, something just removed their senses when they are in office, that they become so insensitive to the plight of the people? You are a governor in a state, a chief security officer of the state, and a decision had been taken. You set up a committee, a panel, to investigate an outcome. And then the panel took a decision, and the people are saying, no, this decision should not be so, because we are yet to see justice melted out over the issues that, you know, happened on this toll gate. So we cannot, let's go back there peacefully and assemble to say, no, we kick against this decision. And the best thing you could do was to deploy brute force against these people, beat them, harass them, detain them, and then you turn around quickly to say, oh, yes, I am not, we notice that some of them acted violently, and you are shown buying roasted plantain on the road. And then, you know, when the barrage of criticism and insult started coming in, they had to deactivate response on the handle.
Yes.
And I asked myself, I said, how insensitive can you be in a state that is as cosmopolitan as Lagos? You can't beat a child and expect that child not to cry. So what those people that make peaceful protests, you know, impossible, make violent change inevitable. So what gradually, like I said before, what the government is saying now is that, no, we can't fight bandits. We are not, with all of these guards, with all of these armories, we can't use them to fight bandits. They are peaceful people. They are people who are law-abiding. But you that is law-abiding, you are the enemy of the state. Mind you, they had threatened before that some persons were threatening to organize, you know, a counter-protest in support of government. Maybe because what they do before now, what they did before, was to unleash thugs on the protesters, and that went, you know, south. And so they probably thought about it and said, no, if we do this again, it might cause further mayhem. And so these thugs you can't control. So the best thing, let us use police on them.
Right.
But the picture they are missing is the fact now that the world has turned to a global village. And so if tomorrow Amnesty International comes out to say Nigeria is a country where human rights is not respected, Alhaji Lai Mohammed will jump up and begin to call names. But these are how they collate their data.
Yes.
Quickly, I want your thoughts on, do you think that this worked in order to prevent a future protest? Do you think that all of these actions that have been taken by the police last weekend will make the hashtag Occupy Lekki Tollgate protesters sit at home next time.
You know, like I told you, like I told you, even during the military era, this didn't work to stop protests. Rather, it fueled protests. Rather, it emboldened some people. It angered some people to say, look, what's the prison capacity in Nigeria? It's about 56,000. And then you have about 63,000 inmates. Yes. And so that is even the excess of, you know, up to 10,000 or so. So if you now arrest, you do the mathematics, you now arrest 500,000 protesters, where are you going to keep them? You know, so they should not push the resilience of the average Nigerian youth, because gradually you're telling them that, look, while we cannot fight you if you're armed, we'll fight you if you're peaceful. So a day will come, rather than being peaceful, they will say, well, the best way to address this issue is let us match them force for force. And at that time, you know, it would be this. Those of us that are bystander might just be caught in the crossfire.
Okay, Nejeeb Bello, I don't know if you saw this video on Saturday. The police had, you know, put people in, you know, the Black Maria in the van, but they tried to start it. They didn't start. that's the video showing on your screen. You can see, you know, operatives there pushing
LCC,
the van.
LCC staff actually pushing their
vehicle. Oh my God,
that's
just hilarious.
And also, I saw conversations about LCC enforcement team. Is that in any way, does it strike you in a different way entirely? Or is this okay that there's an LCC enforcement unit that is used to arrest protesters?
You see, the issue with the van, it just shows the general failure of the system. It shows that there is nothing that we are ready for. Even when they come so well kitted and looking like they have everything together, there's nothing that they are prepared for. So in case something really serious, let's say armed robbers storm the Lekki toll gate and starts robbing the toll collectors one day or the other, they are not even prepared to deal with that kind of situation. But let's go back to the role that LCC has played in this whole disturbance. Aiding and arresting, we need to revisit the laws and know who really owns LCC. We've checked that information and I saw that the LCC is actually owned by Lagos State Government in partnership with the Ikeja Concession Company. We will still find out who Ikeja Concession Company is, because we want to know how come these people have been empowered to own Black Marias, to arrest people, to detain people, and for them to have a vehicle for doing that, it means they didn't even start doing it today. They've been doing it for a very long time. So we investigate that and find out how come they've been a law to themselves or a law to this country. We want to know what gives them that right to arrest. Right. But like I said, this just shows that everything has collapsed. The system is down. For you to come and say you want to arrest protesters, even though what you are doing is illegal, or you even didn't come with the required, you came all kitted with policemen wearing all sorts of grenades on their body, but even the vehicles they brought with them to effect the arrest, right, they were not working. The ambulance, someone right, said they brought an ambulance, a friend of mine, but if anything had happened to any of those protesters, they were chasing protesters across the road.
We're
if we had knocked down a protester, the ambulance would not have worked, nothing inside.
We need to wrap up here. There's a lot of interesting angles that you've brought in, you know, and of course, big question would be why the LCC needs a Black Maria if they're not a security agency. But of course, thank you very much for speaking with us, Nejeeb Bello, and looking forward to another conversation with you.
Thank you for inviting me.
Liborous Oshoma, it's always a pleasure hearing your perspective and your opinion on issues.
Thank you.
Thanks for coming.
Us.
Stay with us. We will be back. And when we come back, we are moving to talk about Mia Tiala and their statements with regards headsmen. They say that nobody can force them out of the Southwest. And so we're having a conversation about that right after the short break.